This is Duke University.
Good afternoon, everyone. For those that don't know me, my name is Patrick Duddy. I am the director of Duke's Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies. By way of background, I'm myself a former Foreign Service officer and retired after 30 years in the State Department and had the good fortune to land here in Durham. Today is obviously not a perfect day, and for those of you who braved wet weather or a long walk in the rain, thank you. We are delighted to see you. We also think it will prove very much worth the effort, as we have with us today Deputy Assistant Secretary of State Alex Lee. I thought perhaps it would be useful as we get started for me to provide first a little bit of background on Alex, and then a little bit of context. The first thing I would note, by the way, is he is presently managing a portfolio that has left most of the rest of us who worked for the State Department in Latin American Affairs insanely jealous. He is the point, the lead, in an effort to rebuild the relationship with Cuba after more than half a century of difficulties, of embargo. It's not an easy process, but it is one I think that many of us who have worked in the region have pondered. And indeed, I know that over the years, any number of my colleagues have sometimes conspired to be assigned to our interest section in Cuba or to the Cuban Affairs Office in Washington, specifically hoping that something would change during their tenure. As you can imagine, lots of folks went through their entire Foreign Service career without ever having even a hint that anything was going to change in a significant way while they were handling one or another part of the portfolio. So first, who is Alex Lee? Alex and I worked together in Panama, where he was the senior political officer at a time when the US was choreographing the transfer of remaining military properties and the Panama Canal to the government of Panama. He is a career Foreign Service officer. Comparing notes earlier, I realized that he was working in the Southern Cone, in his case, Paraguay, back in 1983, at the same time that I and my wife were in Santiago de Chile. So he has 35 years of experience in the Foreign Service. He has served in the field in Latin America, I think 8 times. He has also served as the deputy chief of the U.S. Interest Section in Havana. The U.S. Interest Section, as you know, was the office we maintained, or the facility we maintained in recent years in Havana, instead of having an embassy. Certainly among the most complicated diplomatic posts in the world. and more recently, he's directed the Office of Mexican Affairs and served as, he serves presently indeed, not only as the Deputy Assistant Secretary in charge of the Cuba office, but also as the Deputy Assistant Secretary in charge of all of our missions in South America. Right? If that sounds like a formidable portfolio, I can tell you from my own experience, it is. Indeed, it is one of the biggest in the entire department. As we chatted last night, and again, we've worked together on a number of occasions in the past, Alex noted that he was spending fully half of his time on an island in the Caribbean, as opposed to working the Colombian, Brazilian, Venezuelan, Argentine portfolios. But I think most of us would agree that's pretty predictable. Within the hemisphere, and I'm just going to mention a couple of sort of contextual things before I turn this over to Alex. U.S. policy vis-a-vis Cuba has long been one of the most polemical aspects of U.S. policy for Latin America. In recent years, it has been the source of considerable friction with many of the countries with which we have otherwise very positive cooperative relationships. At the same time, any of us working in hemispheric affairs in Washington always knew that Cuba policy was going to be hard to change, in part because of the very strong domestic constituencies against change. Even as we saw the development of some folks, some advocates for a new approach to the hemisphere, we also collectively recognized that there was a very strong domestic constituency against. And I would add, from my own point of view, one of the things that has long been true is that the Cuban government never made it any easier for the US government to change directions. Now, last year's announcement that the Obama administration would renew relations with Cuba, I think, took many of us by surprise. It was largely welcomed within the region. It was welcomed in some parts of our own government and populace, but it was also greeted with alarm by other elements. What I hope that we can do today is explore a little bit with Alex what this process has felt like, looked like, what he is encountering as the Deputy Assistant Secretary, what his specific responsibilities are, and what he and his colleagues at the Department of State hope to accomplish and believe can be accomplished in the remaining months of the Obama administration, and indeed what he thinks the future holds for the relationship. Without further preamble, then, I give you Deputy Assistant Secretary Alex Lee.
Well, thank you very much, Patrick, and thank you very much for coming today on a rainy day. It has been my privilege to work on Cuban affairs. As Patrick noted, I had been DCM for 2 years in our interest section during the Bush administration when relations were quite strained. And both sides went out of their way to exacerbate the strain in the bilateral relationship. And so it's been somewhat interesting for me to be part of the process of thinking through for Uncle Sam how we could turn this relationship around and serve our national interests, given the heartfelt and strong opinions by many that this is a regime which the United States should not truck with in any way, but also reflecting the recognition that we were completely isolated in the hemisphere, and this policy not only no longer served our national interests, but had not served our national interests for, I'm not going to specify how long. But clearly, when President Obama came in to office, he wanted to rethink the relationship. We got early signals of that when he did the first two rounds in his first administration of regulatory changes that, in effect, greatly increased the amount, the ability of travel to the island, expanded the scope, and also expanded the amounts of remittances to go to Cuba. But the calculation in the administration was that further movement in the bilateral relationship really needed to reflect a couple of realities. One, we needed to secure the release of Alan Gross. Another was that we wanted to have a normal. We wanted to embark on a more normal relationship so our mission in Havana could actually have access to all elements of Cuba and Cuban society, because both the Cuban government did its level best to scare away average Cubans from coming into contact with our officials, and also Cubans exercised kind of a self restraint from engaging with us because it could cost them problems. We also wanted to expand the areas of bilateral cooperation in areas that were, we thought would be mutually useful. So what we used were these twice a year migration discussions and to look at migration sets of issues, which both countries, no matter how difficult the bilateral relationship, generally tried to continue. Not always, sometimes they were suspended. But these were our only kind of formal mechanisms to engage with each other. And we use this mechanism to talk about migration issues, but also kind of tentatively explore those areas that we could cooperate. And so when I first started working in this portfolio in June of 13, I knew that my mandate was to try to expand those areas. And so that's what we tried to do. And so we pushed forward things like establishing protocols for oil prevention spills, or new protocols for search and rescue, or greater cooperation on trafficking in persons, an area that we really had no idea the extent of some of the things the Cuban government was doing. In a positive sense, tentatively deepen our counter-narcotics cooperation, tentatively identify areas for cooperation in an environmental, particularly in our marine areas. Some of these were very tentative, and some of them we actually pursued and deepened, all at the same time while we were trying to figure out how to secure Alan Gross's release. Now, while I was doing all of this, my colleagues in the NSC were actually doing the secret negotiations for the release of Alan. And the interesting part of that is that conversation went further because we wanted to push for and persuade the Cubans to reestablish diplomatic relations, and initially they weren't so receptive. Anyway, all of this led to kind of the historic announcement on December 17th, where President Obama said, "We are committed to reestablishing diplomatic relations. I have asked Secretary Kerry to initiate the negotiations in this process. I have asked Secretary Kerry to look at removing Cuba from the state sponsor of terrorism list. We want to move forward. And in addition, I'm announcing a series of regulatory changes that significantly facilitated people-to-people travel." A little bit about the regulatory changes before I move forward. The embargo remains firmly in place. The embargo is law of the land. The embargo can only be changed by congressional decision. The president does have an authority to make exceptions and policy exceptions. And when we were crafting those regulatory changes that were announced formally in January of this year, and then another set in September, we were looking at ways that to expand in three different areas. And there are exceptions to the law. And we have to be careful to figure out where we could go. But the policy goal of those three areas were facilitate people-to-people travel, and you can see a whole bunch of the regulatory changes in that basket. Things like expanding the and facilitating the numbers of people to travel to Cuba under purposeful travel, because the embargo prohibits travel by tourism, but we've greatly facilitated people-to-people travel. We also have facilitated the means of this travel, whether by allowing our airlines to enter into what we're beginning negotiations, or have actually begun negotiations with Cuba, to have regularly scheduled airline service, have regularly scheduled passenger ferry service. And so those sets of regulations are to facilitate what we would call people-to-people. Another key area in kind of piercing the embargo for specific policy reasons was telecommunications. It's long been a US government policy plank to try to facilitate communication within the island and off the island. And we've done certain things that, you know, haven't worked and has been a learning process. And I think the announcement of the opening of diplomatic relations allowed us to be much more bolder. And in fact, it's really quite bold what the president has done, because the president has authorized, it's the only area, telecommunications, where American businesses are authorized to enter into joint ventures with a Cuban government entity, in this case, a ATEXA, which is a Cuban government telecom monopoly, in order to facilitate phone service and internet service. Interestingly enough, the Cubans have gladly taken up phone service to make it cheaper. They're rather skittish on the internet part, but we can talk about that later. So that's another major area, an exception to the rules of the embargo. And then a third area is our efforts to figure out how to create an incentive structure for the Cuban government to allow the flow of certain authorized goods into Cuba that go to, and that the customer in the end will be Cuban civil society in its most wide spectrum. And that's an important concept. It's Cuban civil society. It's not the Cuban state. And so that's why you have to keep in mind that the only authorized part for American businesses to work is with on telecoms. There's obviously an exception to agriculture and medicines, and been longstanding for the past 15 years, where American companies can sell directly to the Cuban government, knowing that the end user is going to be a Cuban government hotel or restaurant. But again, reflecting the constrictions of the embargo, we crafted these sets of regulatory changes to open both ways, trading, exchanging, to the Cuban private sector. Now, there is one thing to keep in mind. The embargo is, even if you got rid of the embargo, you would still require Congress to approve of, get rid of several other pieces of important legislation. One of them is most favored nation. Cuba and North Korea are the only two countries in the world that don't enjoy most favored nation. What that means is, Cuba really can't export anything to the United States more than $800 in any shipment, because then it starts running into really high tariff barriers. We couldn't do anything about that, but we wanted, as part of this, creating an incentive for the Cuban government to rethink what's in its national interest and facilitate them to say, yes, go forward on internet. Services is completely open. So, you know, a Cuban person wanting to use the internet for business is completely, and selling those goods to the United States is completely open. Anyway, what I'm trying to get at is the whole regulatory part, because of the embargo, because of all these other laws, is like a Rubik's Cube. And you can never get the perfect and most logical exception. You have to figure out, you know, where the laws allow you to make exceptions. So those are the three areas in our regulatory changes. I would argue they're very significant. We're looking at ways to improve it. The second round, we figured out ways to help U.S. businesses and U.S. educational institutions operationalize the opportunities of the regulatory changes. So that's a major contribution to changing the nature of the relationship. We had a set of negotiations to define the parameters of how our respective missions would work. Those were concluded, and on July 20th, we formally established diplomatic relations. Secretary Kerry went down there on August 14th. It was a lovely ceremony. One of the touches of the ceremony that I found endearing was we found the three Marines that in 1961 had hauled down the U.S. flag when we were closing our mission there. The three Marines were still alive, and they had made a pledge to each other that should the U.S. ever reestablish diplomatic relations, they wanted to be there. Well, we helped them along, and we invited them to come to the ceremony when we raised the flag. And it was kind of a touching moment. So now both sides have established a really ambitious agenda to cooperate on. It's an agenda that includes need for addressing claims, property claims on both sides, an agenda that includes negotiating the terms of civil aviation, regular flights. It's an agenda that includes discussions on telecom and telecom communication, what we can do to narrow the differences. It's an agenda that includes human rights. Really, the agenda is so ambitious that we established something called the Bilateral Commission, or the Bilateral Steering Commission, to act as a traffic cop, essentially, to establish priorities for engagement and meetings and visits, and to space it out enough so both sides can prepare and make meaningful progress, because both sides know we have a deadline. Well, we have kind of a symbolic deadline in December 17th, but we also have the deadline of the end of President Obama's administration, and we both want to advance as much as we want, as we can. So we are very much in that process. They are, as you can imagine, significant areas of disagreement. We profoundly disagree with the Cuban government's treatment of those exercising peacefully their ability or desire, you know, to express dissent. This whole process has been accompanied by a surge in the Cuban government's use of kind of what we colloquially call catch and release, in which basically they arrest, sometimes preemptively, Cubans that they know are going to march in front of a church or make a statement somehow, arbitrarily, sometimes with, you know, physical violence. And we deplore this, and we call them out all the time. We have, so in their areas in which there are sharp disagreements, but at the same time, both sides have identified areas that are in our respective national interests that an objective person looking at will say, you know, this makes sense. We should be cooperating on trafficking in person and sharing information. We should be sharing information on law enforcement cooperation. Cubans want to do that. We want to do that. This is not a sprint, this is a marathon, but I would argue that what we have done in the past 10 months is really rather dramatic, particularly if you compare it to a policy approach of isolation that we had employed for 54 years. I could go on, but I'll stop there. Thank you.
That's terrific, and I think that what you have already accomplished is really quite remarkable. What I intend to do with the rest of our time is I'm going to ask a few questions and then preserve as much time as I can for all of you to ask questions. But I couldn't resist taking advantage of my seat in the front of the room to ask some of the things that I've wanted to know ever since this process started. And the, you know, in a sense, the first and the biggest question, knowing that the we continued to have some people we considered spies, Cubans considered heroes of their revolution in our prisons. They had Alan Gross. What, in the context of that negotiation, convinced the Cuban government that after 50 years, they were ready to begin the process of renewing relations? As my own recollection is that, you know, expressions of goodwill notwithstanding in the United States, the working assumption among many American diplomats had always been that the Cuban government used the difficult relationship with the United States, at least in part, to justify the certain measures that, in effect, kept them in place and in power. So how did we move from that standoff to discussions on cooperation? What convinced them?
Well, I can only guess from my variety of my very disciplined Cuban counterparts, negotiators. But I would probably, I'll put forward what I think are some of the key elements. One, I think, was Raul Castro replacing his brother, because Raul Castro is a much more pragmatic leader. He recognized that the Cuban economy, and he's publicly stated this in a variety of ways, is in a disastrous situation, and the model needed to change. And he was willing to begin a process of internal economic reform. One can question how that is going way too slow in order to meet the challenges of the global economy, but he initiated that process, and I do not think Fidel would have ever done that. I think that's one key element. Another key element, never acknowledged by the Cuban negotiators, but I think was always in the back of their minds, was the perilous and disastrous state of their number one ally, Venezuela. And they could see what was happening in Venezuela just falling apart in front of their eyes. And so that led them to, maybe we should diversify a bit, you know, our engagement, and maybe there is a way of engaging the United States so it is no longer a threat to the revolution. I think that was probably another calculation there. At a more tactical level, and the presence of President Obama, who had clearly signaled to the Cuban government a willingness to have a different kind of relationship with Cuba. Those, I think, are kind of the three big macro elements. At a more tactical level, I think that even though my colleagues in the NSC, when they started the secret negotiations to free Alan Gross, it became clear to the Cubans that we were not prepared to do a straight trade for Alan Gross and the five or four Cuban spies, depending on the time we're talking. And it wasn't until the Cubans were persuaded that a Cuban spy of ours, a Cuban national, but who had spied for us, who had actually served his jail term but was still in jail, should be part of this package, that the Cubans, it took them a while to absorb that that was our essential element for an agreement. But in that process, we suggested, my colleagues suggested, that, you know, we should take advantage of this and change the course of this relationship. And that trust-building exercise at one channel and the trust-building exercise done through directly, you know, the State Department and the Cuban Foreign Ministry were both elements that basically brought together and helped along by the Pope, no question about it, helped basically both sides to say, okay, we will take the risk and move forward.
Thanks. Now, as a follow-up to that question, I have to ask, did the United States find itself compelled or persuaded that it would desist from activities the regime in Cuba finds threatening as a condition of renewing relations? Because in the past, we've always assumed that many of our civil society programs were objectionable to the Cuban government, principally because they saw them as a long-term threat to its survival.
The Cubans pushed hard. They continue to push hard. But both the secretary and the president, you know, have said that these programs that are, you know, kind of colloquially known as the democracy programs will continue. This is one of those areas in which both governments disagree. We believe that it's important as a matter of principle to help Cuban civil society, you know, express its views. And we believe this is a value that we need to champion. Cuba is, after all, a signer of a variety of international covenants, which commits them to this. And essentially, we're asking them to live up to these international commitments. But, you know, again, both sides have different views.
Right.
The difference is that in the discussions, we basically have respectful conversations as opposed to stony dissertations looking at each other.
Again, a follow-up to that, which for a short answer, they understand then that that we will continue, for instance, to report on human rights, and not simply to occasionally comment on particular incidents that we find egregious, but that we will do the same sort of routine reporting as we have done in the past?
Absolutely.
I'd like to just change the focus ever so slightly with a quick question. You and I have both worked throughout the region. You are presently responsible for all of South America and all of its complexities, as well as the Office of Cuban Affairs. How has, number one, the rest of the region responded to this overture? And specifically, since I think many recognize, and it's evident in the press within the region, many recognize that the Cuban government is an authoritarian government in most respects, and that many of the same privileges, for instance, that Brazilians exercise are not available to Cubans. Has the rest of the region signaled a willingness to work with the United States and Cuba to bring all of the relationship forward?
Well, on your first question, the reaction from Latin America, not just South America, but Latin America, was overwhelmingly positive, And that was really one of the huge dividends for foreign policy practitioners of the United States, that essentially we removed what many of us had considered a an albatross, you know, on our ability to engage, particularly in multilateral fora, with otherwise solid partners. So the immediate payoff in foreign policy terms was very, very positive, but also globally. It did kind of take some of the ALBA countries by surprise, and I think Venezuelans.
That includes Ecuador, obviously, Bolivia.
And Venezuela, and Nicaragua. And I think Venezuela in particular was kind of taken aback by this this apparent rapprochement between the United States and Cuba. Your second question is, however positive this was viewed, I think there is a natural reluctance by most of the governments in the region to insert themselves in this process. It's clear that some of the governments, including some of the governments left of center, recognize that Cuba needs to or should evolve towards a more open and accountable and responsive government. But they believe that what we have set off, a process, a dynamic, that will achieve that over time. And so they're content, in effect, to let it play out.
One of the most puzzling aspects of U.S. policy toward Cuba, in particular because it was so unique even within the region, has been our policy on known as wet foot, dry foot. Basically, a policy that suggested that any Cuban who fled Cuba and was intercepted before reaching U.S. territory would be returned to Cuba. But any Cuban who fled the island and managed to actually put a foot on U.S. territory, a dry foot, if you will, could stay. Where does the rapprochement that has happened in the last 10 months leave us vis-a-vis that policy?
Yeah, both the Secretary and the President have made clear that the Cuban Adjustment Act and the related executive orders known colloquially as wet foot, dry foot are going to remain in place. There are a variety of reasons for that. But I think one of them is the recognition that this is an issue that can set off reactions on the island at a popular level. Because every time there's a discussion of this issue and it's registered in Cuba, you will see a spike of individuals risking their lives to cross the Florida Straits or come across through either Central America and Mexico. So we have made clear to the Cubans and to Cuban society that the Cuban Adjustment Act or changes to wet foot, dry foot are not going to happen in this administration.
There is a related, in a sense, body of policy, also with sort of separate legal status, known as the Helms-Burton Act. So that we not only have considerations in indemnifying U.S. citizens who may have lost property in the revolution, we have a policy, at least on the books, rarely fully applied, that suggests that for other companies from other countries which agree to do business in Cuba, and in doing so, if I understand it correctly, use properties that were seized from American citizens, are subject to U.S. sanctions. Has that been rolled back? Is it still enforced? And if so, will changing that be easier than lifting the embargo?
Well, it's all part and parcel of the embargo as codified by the Helms-Burton Act. Virtually all presidents since the Libertad Act was passed, the Helms-Burton Act in 96, have used the waiver. And so there's essentially one...
That's a provision of the law.
Right, a provision of the law. So there is one company that is sanctioned, and then we've exercised a waiver for other companies. And so that has been true for Republican and Democratic presidents. The Helms-Burton Act essentially says, you know, the only way for this law to terminate is if, among other things, Cuba has either a transition government or a democratically elected government. Failing that, the embargo remains in place if and until Congress basically votes to override it. And so this is the Helms-Burton Act is many folks identify it as kind of a piece of legislation that really took away purposefully executive authority and its ability to conduct foreign relations with respect to a specific country and channel it in a very narrow way. So the law is very much on the books, and it's one that we need to respect.
Yes, ma'am.
I have two questions. First of all, will Cubans be allowed to reciprocate their tourism and travel to the United States? This is my first question. And the second question has to do with Alan Gross. Was he a spy? Because, you know, we maintain he wasn't, they maintain he was. And how difficult were the negotiations, and what were they to get them out?
Okay, well, I'll start with Alan first.
Okay, for others who would like to, I hope you all got that question. Others who have questions can queue up over here so we can get it recorded.
Alan most definitely wasn't a spy. What Alan was, he was a subcontractor for a company that had received a USAID grant. What he was doing was trying to essentially give away technology that would allow, in the particular case of when he was arrested, a Jewish synagogue to establish a direct internet link off the island, bypassing the Cuban government control. So that he broke Cuban law, no question. One can argue whether what he was doing was, you know, facilitating, you know, communication in a way congruent with Cuba's obligations. It's a separate discussion. The negotiations were very frustrating because we knew that he wasn't a spy. The Cubans really knew he wasn't a spy. And he suffered 5 years of being imprisoned, and it was very traumatic for him. And so we would visit him as frequently as possible. He had a whole parade of visitors coming to see him, which helped him deal with his circumstance. But, you know, the visitors would leave and he'd still be there. Anyway, we were very happy that it worked out and he was freed. Now, on travel, actually Cubans have been able to travel, ever since the intersection has been set up. The difference is, and it really was a fundamental difference, is that in January 2014, the Cuban government removed the requirement for an explicit exit permission. And that greatly increased the number of Cubans traveling. And then the Cubans subsequently made their own policy change that allowed Cubans to go and leave the island, as long as they left the island legally, as opposed to on a raft, that they could stay out for 2 years and then come back. The problem is that, it's a very poor society, and really the ones that can travel essentially need some family members here in the U.S. to pay the bills and get by the passport and all of that. But the number of Cubans leaving the island and traveling has greatly increased. So when people talk about the surge of travel, because since President Obama announced the relaxation in the people-to-people, let's say from the beginning of this year alone, Americans, whether Cuban Americans or Americans not of Cuban descent traveling to Cuba, has increased by 35%. It's been a real jump. But also Cubans coming to the U.S. has greatly increased. And this gets me to a slightly different point. One of the things we're trying to do is to promote that two-way. And one of the areas is academic exchanges. We actually have lots of Americans studying in Cuba. Last year, in calendar year 14, we had 8,000 American students studying Cuba. The trick is to try to figure out and engineer incentives and the ability to bring that flow of Cubans to study in the U.S. We did some research, and in 2013 and 2014, to the best of our knowledge, exactly 64 Cubans came to the U.S. to study in the United States.
But that wasn't because we were blocking them.
That wasn't because we were blocking them. There's just, you know, A, they've been discouraged from doing it. B, they don't know how to do it. C, they don't have the resources. So that's something that we're trying to work and encourage academic institutions to figure out how to increase that two-way flow. As a way of comparison, Vietnam, with our own, you know, long and sometimes troubled and now quite good relationship, last year Vietnam sent 15,000 Vietnamese to study in the United States.
You queue up over here so that we can record you. And while they're getting ready to ask the question, I just have one quick observation. We've talked variously about the U.S. interest section. How big was it before it was transformed into an embassy? How many staff, et cetera?
We were under a cap of 51 Americans, of which 10 or 11 were U.S. Marines. So it really was quite a lean operation. It was primarily a consular operation because we virtually didn't have any relations with the Cuban government, whether at the federal or the government or the provincial or the local level. Whatever relationships we did were exclusively channeled either through the foreign ministry or reflecting a kind of a long-term relationship that we have built over the years, the Coast Guard, with their Cuban Coast Guard counterparts. And those were essentially the two big exceptions.
Okay, thank you. And we will now take questions from the mic.
All right, I have a two-part question, but it's on the same issue. The embargo. In order for the embargo to be ended in Congress, is it a simple majority vote that's needed, or is it a supermajority? And the second part of that question is, what are the chances or the likelihood of something like that ever being brought down to the floor for a vote?
Okay. Well, you know, at least on the Senate side, you'd have to have a quorum, which would be 60, most likely. That's probably the limit on the Senate side. And on the House side, just a simple majority. Now, I think you have seen, we have seen, a significant increase of support for abolishing the embargo in the Senate. I'm not sure that there's a majority yet, but whereas maybe 2 years ago you maybe had a hearty band of, you know, five or six senators that argued for this, now you're going to have 15, 20 senators basically supportive, maybe not out in front, but supportive, and the numbers grow. On the House side, I would say that the majority of opinion is still staunchly against relinquishing or voting down the embargo. So my personal guess is that there will be no movement on the embargo fundamentally through this congressional term. So we'll have to see how the elections happen and the various dynamics next time around. That said, there are a whole bunch of legislative proposals to alter parts of it, of the embargo. The one that seems to have gathered the most support is to remove the travel ban of the embargo. And that one on the Senate side, if I remember right, and please don't quote me, but you could look it up easy enough, may have as many as 40 co-sponsors on the Senate side. So you're seeing an evolution in Congress. And on the Republican side, it's kind of interesting because where the defections are occurring on the Republican side tend to be farm state Republicans, very mindful of the opportunities for agricultural sales to Cuba. And that's basically where you'll start seeing a differentiation within Republican views.
Why don't we take two or three questions in a row quickly so that those of you who are in the hall can come back in and listen to the answers. Please, sir.
The rapprochement, while inevitable, came as a sort of surprise to some of us, given the fact that last year President Obama also doubled the bounty on Asada Shakur from 2 to 4 million, which could be seen as a possible sponsorship of possible mercenary interventions into Cuba. I was wondering what role the placement of Asada Shakur is playing in the negotiations of rapprochement, and if there is any chance the administration might take the bounty off of her head.
Let's take another quick question.
Throughout Cuba, there seem to be many, many huge billboards, anti-American, anti-imperialist billboards, although they seem to be concentrated around Giron, where the Bay of Pigs took place, and in the town of Guantanamo, but they're everywhere. And I was wondering if there was any talk or any change in those huge billboards. Thank you.
Okay.
One more.
One more?
Please, one of you, quick question. Yeah.
Hello, thank you so much for coming today, and thank you, Ambassador Duddy, for moderating this. I'm a student here at Duke. I studied abroad in Cuba last semester, so I was one of those 8,000 students that were there. My question has to relate to when I was in Cuba, Governor Cuomo of New York came to visit and spoke with a group of U.S. students there, and I was part of that group. And for those of you who don't know, his trip was sort of to get New York in the door, first foot in the door into Cuba, and to start negotiating business there. So CEO of JetBlue, Chobani Yogurt, and a variety of other different businesses. I was wondering, when you're going through these negotiations, how do you moderate business in this? How do you moderate big business and possibly imperialist business, such as United Fruit Company throughout Latin America in the past? And what is the negotiations on a state level and a federal level when handling these negotiations?
Okay. Let me do the first two questions first.
And then we'll get to this gentleman for the final question. How about that?
Part of the law enforcement dialogue that both countries want to discuss, there are two components of it. And one is what I mentioned initially, the desire of both countries to establish first an understanding of what kinds of law enforcement information we can share and we cannot share, and then establishing protocols for the handling of that information and understanding how that information is used. And so that is a big driver of both sides wanting to hold these conversations. Another driver is that, you know, we have probably approximately 80 U.S. American fugitives on the island. And we would very much want to have particularly those that were convicted of serious crimes return to the United States. How that will turn out, those sets of discussions, I'm not going to go into right now. But clearly, we would very much like to have these American fugitives return to the U.S., and it's part of the discussion. With the second question of the billboards is, I can't speak for the billboards outside of Havana. The Cuban government was nice enough for when we were opening our embassy to remove them. We didn't ask them to do it, but they did. I think the more important question, or more important reality, is Cuban population was overwhelmingly enthusiastic of the opening of our embassy and having the reestablishment of diplomatic relations. Polling, and yes, there is an ability for companies to conduct polling in Cuba, showed this repeatedly. And anyone who has spent time in Cuba knows that Cubans are actually very positively inclined to the United States, reflecting, in many cases, rather good understanding of the U.S., if nothing else, that many members of their family live in the U.S. and come back and forth with some frequency. On the
business
part, clearly the Cuban government recognizes that it needs to attract foreign investment. This is part of Raul's plank for reform. The Cuban government wants to attract a kind of foreign investment that puts it together with Cuban entities, state-owned entity. They're not particularly interested in private enterprise per se. Matter of fact, they don't really acknowledge, there is no juridical protections for what we would call entrepreneurs or what are the phenomena of cuenta propistas, which are essentially mom and pop businesses that have exploded in Cuba in the past couple of years. So the Cuban government's conception is to try to bring in investment to marry it with a state government initiative. There have been some companies that have been successful in the hotel industry. Another signature initiative is the Port of Mariel. But many, many companies, when they look at Cuba, and I'm just reporting what I hear from potential investors, is that they're discouraged by the lack of transparency and predictability in terms of arbitral safeguards. So if there's a dispute with the Cuban government, who makes the decision? And that's very unclear. Also, many foreign investors are put off by the fact that the Cuban government hires hires the people that can work with the Cuban, the foreign investor. So, for example, if a hotel, someone wants to establish a hotel, it's the Cuban government that provides this, the employees.
And identifies the
identifies the persons and say, you can pick from these people, but these are the people who are authorized to work with you. You cannot hire anybody except these people. The Cuban government does this because they essentially lop off, depends on the, but they lop off a significant portion of that individual's income, and they pocket it. And so the net result is that Cuban labor is very expensive vis-a-vis the rest of the island. So if a company is interested in, bringing in a paint factory, and Lord knows paint is in high demand in Havana, that person has to say, okay, what is my profit margin if this labor is so incredibly expensive when I could just ship it in? So they are, even though the government is trying to attract foreign investment, has written a new investment law, it doesn't make it easy for investors to come in. Investors have essentially, the Brazilians have flirted a little bit, but they haven't really put any real significant money down. There's some Israeli investment. But agriculture, for example, has attracted very, very little foreign investment. And the reality is that the most desirous elements of Cuban economy are essentially controlled by the Cuban military, and that includes, you know, the tourist industry. And they've essentially ring-fenced that. They will, in certain cases, manage and give management contracts to foreign companies, like in Melilla, a Spanish company. But they very much control that area. So we'll have to see. But I would argue the bigger danger in Cuba is that Cuba is going to move too slowly to take advantage of this tremendous surge of interest in Cuba, and big investors will start looking elsewhere because it's so hard to do business there.
I think we have time for one more question, and you've been waiting very patiently.
Yeah, thanks. Kind of just jumping off of that last point about investment, my question's about the telecommunications and the kind of, so as in most people know in Cuba, there's only one newspaper and no real freedom of the press. So I'm wondering if the telecommunications or the drive towards having something like open internet, is that all rationalized on the policy side as being an avenue through which something like freedom of the press can be approximated? Also, separate but related, why is the rationale to do it as a joint, like how is the joint ventures going to be managed if it does come to fruition through the internet instead of just providing the infrastructure? Is that also in order to kind of solicit and provide, facilitate some sort of like openness to the internet to prevent things from being blocked? And this can be extrapolated beyond, but to keep it in the frame of telecommunications, I have done work in Cuba before and I hopefully we'll continue to do so. One of the biggest problems, especially with like pharmaceuticals and other things that have already come into the island from the US, is precisely because the wages are depressed and kept so low, is there any sort of plan or discussion about how to subsidize or create an internet that can be affordable for the general Cuban population who makes, $20 a month, when that still seems to be an issue in other places like Puerto Rico and other,
Okay, well, this is a topic near and dear to my heart, and I think is really kind of a fascinating window of trying to provide incentives for change, but it's really the other partner, in this case, the counterpart, that has to make a decision on how they're going to go about it. The regulatory changes were designed to remove all justification that the United States was in any way responsible for blocking bilateral communication flows between both countries. And so they authorized not only the sale of lots of hardware involved.
That is the Cubans authorized?
Yeah, we authorized. We authorized a sale to Cuba.
Oh, I got it.
Of all sorts of hardware, of telecommunications, services. And the reason we authorized the joint venture is if an American company wanted to enter into a joint service, and we were not by any means dictating because we don't have that kind of government, they would be allowed to do it, provided the Cuban government itself was interested. I'm not certain that the Cuban government really is. The Cuban government has had joint ventures with Italian company. They feel, in reality, much more comfortable with joint ventures with a Chinese company because, essentially, what they're trying to do is create an intranet with all of the ability to block internet information that comes off the island, and that is a primary governing concern of theirs to try to control the flow of information. We understand that. We recognize that. So in making, in removing all of the U.S. restrictions on the U.S. side, and in allowing joint ventures and being the, picking that area as the most forward-leaning, another thing that we did was when we were figuring out, remember I talked about this most favored nation tariff cap that kind of inhibits the flow of goods from Cuba to the United States, well, we deliberately were able and taking advantage of a possibility in the regulatory changes to allow services. So for some internet entrepreneur on the island, if they wanted to do translations, they wanted to do apps, they wanted to even do building blueprints, provided that they had the necessary certifications for the place that they were sending the blueprints in the United States, that is wide open. And we are trying to work through the various problems, like on PayPal, to make to operationalize all of this, because essentially what we were trying to do is, in telecoms, create an incentive structure. And I had a conversation with the professor there last night when I was trying to make the argument. Create an incentive structure for, let's say, a son of the Ministry of Interior, which is kind of the police arm, which is the, at the forefront of clamping down on behavior that they consider unacceptable, a son or a daughter of a Mint official to say, hey, Dad, you know, this business of, you know, making it difficult for the internet is dumb, because what does Cuba have? We have human capital. We have invested all these resources in human capital. We don't really produce much. We have some fine cigars, some fine rum. But what we really have are doctors, you know. Why don't we use this human capital, marry it to the internet, and make money, Dad? But to do that, they have to drop that paradigm, which has been one of the essence of the regime, of controlling all information. Now, why they stick to that paradigm, I do not know. Because if you've been on the island, you know that Cubans, whether through the paquete or through phone calls, are actually very well informed about what's happening in the US. So why the Cuban government insists upon, you know, the censorship and this spoon feeding in their television and grandma, which sometimes is ludicrous, and everybody makes fun of it, when
even the Cubans make
even the Cubans make fun of it. So that's the kind of debate we hope. I have no idea how it's going to turn out, but I'm glad that they're having the debate.
Well, listen, this has been really wonderful for all of us. There may be a few minutes for some of you to ask questions. Up here at the end, but we do have to wrap this up. This has been just a wonderful discussion. There's a lot more to discuss. We haven't gotten to radio and television Martí. We haven't talked about Guantanamo. And I would, you know, I fully intend to, you know, cross-examine you in the car on the way to our next event. But I'd like to thank you on behalf of all of us here at the Franklin Center and at the Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies and the larger community here at Duke, for agreeing to come down and for speaking to us so openly about what is clearly an historic process. Yeah. So thank you very much.